As a literary scholar, cultural historian, and content creator, I'll observe Italian design and yachting from a slightly different perspective than usual, as both an entrepreneurial and an intellectual language, as a hybrid space in between what we call culture and what we call industry. I hope you will appreciate at the end of my talk how culture, which means cultivation, and industry, which means industriousness, are actually connected activities which relate to a common work of optimization, common tension to create lasting fruits, and a common idea of profit as both an intellectual and material benefit. If you want to see what is unique in Italian design, we need to start exactly here. From the premise that a product of Italy, in fact, is both cultural and industrial, that the Italian object is endowed with an intellectual, historical, and imaginative echo chamber, which is what conveys upon it a particular flair, gusto, or style. Italian design doesn't necessarily coincide with the shortcut label made in Italy. Italian design does not mean that the entirety of a product, meaning capital, labor, creativity, execution, distribution, is made in Italy by Italians. As you know, Italian companies are often related to non-Italian holdings or hire non-Italian designers, and great Italian designers work in non-Italian companies, as in the cases of Francesca Bellettini, creative director of Yves Saint Laurent, Maria Grazia Chiuri, a creative director at Dior, Mauro Porcini, chief designer at Pepsi, or Milena Canonero, four-time Academy Award winner for costume design in Hollywood. So, what makes a product Italian then? What does the Italian appeal consist of? What plus value does Italian add to design or a product? To answer these questions, we need to go back to the cultural roots of Italian flair. To the secret link between an Italian product and its larger, deeper imagery, to the echo chamber that connects quality of execution, attention to detail, and creativity to a distinctive imagination, philosophy, and lifestyle. What I will show you today, then, is not a history of Italian designers or a chronology of Italian design, but rather its genealogy. That is, its sources, how its echo chamber was formed, how the Italian cultural milieu enabled Italian brands or objects to gain a particular aura of distinction. It is in this cultural soil that we can detect the living spring of Italy's unique approach to creativity and industrial success. It is in this environment that the Italian product draws depth, originality, genuineness, authenticity, freshness. Or, in other words, is flair, from the Latin flagrare, to burn, indicating fragrance. So it is in this space that the Italian design evolves from an art of styling into a storytelling platform, a laboratory of visual gestures, and an asystematic philosophy of innovation. Here is my plan for today. I will give a general overview of the elements that distinguish Italy's operative approach to design, vis-à-vis the Anglo-Saxon model. I will then explore the cultural sources that define Italy's unique way to creativity in the visual arts, literature, and philosophy. Lastly, I will observe this story in relation to yachting. What is the operative model of Italian industry and design? Is there a plan, you might ask? If we look at the first industrial development in the late 19th century, the answer is no. While England, Germany, France, and the US enacted a systematic process of modernization, Italian industrialization grew instead without a master plan, as the outcome of foreign investments, especially on infrastructures, and an unstructured patchwork of territorial skills and networks. Scholars often refer to Italy's lack of systematic strategy, industrial delay, and persistence of artisanal modes of production with the formula incomplete modernity. What I show in my scholarly work on the origins of Italian industrial culture is that this unstructured approach or incompleteness does not represent a flaw, but rather Italy's greatest source of creative advantage and competitive distinction, at least for three reasons. First, industrial delay forced Italian companies to differentiate their products and find a competitive niche. Faced with a preoccupied large-scale market, Italian manufacturer positioned itself in the premium niche, bypassing serialization with quality and overcoming average or standardization with the deliberate addition of a philosophical, aesthetical, or cultural element to products, hence the luxury positioning. Second, the incomplete industrial transition formed an intermediate approach to production in between artisanal craft and serial manufacture. Faced with the urgency to find a distinctive voice, yet also to compete in the industrial market, this hybrid way to production engendered a restless or rather experimental attitude, which saw manufacture as a process of synthesis and endless adjustment. So freshness as the outcome of rootedness and flexibility. Third, the unstructured growth of Italian industrialism allowed it to develop around districts of excellence, so silk near Como, violins near Cremona, etc., and develop around unplanned encounters, mostly between artists and entrepreneurs. So Italian industrialism as a patchwork of particular stories, and the Italian object as the expression of a personal story. In my academic work and on YouTube, I reconstruct this unplanned story case by case through the profiles of its protagonists, assembling a coherent vision of Italy's irregular industrialism and its hybrid aesthetics in between beauty and technology, avant-garde and craft, heritage and innovation. Now, in the traits we highlighted in the early industrial age, we can already see the core of Italy's later success in the years of the economic boom after World War II, which we can narrow down to the idea of turning serial items into works of art. We see this in the collaboration of the futurist painters Umberto Boccioni with bicycle designer Edoardo Bianchi, or Fortunato De Perro with Davide Campari. We can also see this idea in the work of fashion designer Rosa Genoni, who won a gold medal at the 1906 exposition of Milan for reinventing Botticelli's spring in a modern primavera dress. But how does this initial story translate today? How does this model apply? We can certainly list some of the characteristics that define Italy's overall approach to design and innovation by comparing them with Anglo-Saxon models. So here is a quick and by necessity general outline. So the intuitive overall vision of the product as an artistic synthesis vis-a-vis process-oriented development, the small size workshop or studio with its implied model of learning by doing or doing from scratch, vis-a-vis a strategic compartmentalization of skills. The idea of innovation as a polyglot, polymath invention of the object's meanings, vis-a-vis incremental modification of existing products. The luxury positioning vis-a-vis the big scale market. And lastly, the emphasis on styling, not as rational functionality, but rather as an emotional act aimed at crafting dreams. So design objects and signifiers are not solely practical tools, but emotional components and semiotic indicators of a larger aesthetic space. Now, a mere description of differences, however, while allowing us to decipher a productive system, is surely not enough to explain the influence, the attraction, and the flair that surrounds Italian objects. To see where this appeal comes from, we need to take a dive into their cultural and imaginative space. And here is where the Italian setting becomes an original source of distinction. Why? Because the success of an object is not solely related to its execution or sales, but rather to its capacity to gain relevance and eventually become timeless. Ultimately, every object or brand aspires to become classic, or rather, as the Latin root classis indicates, part of a select fleet of immortal masterpieces. It works the same way for a literary work, music or painting. And in this sense, the question we need to consider in approaching Italian design is, how does a contingent object remain memorable, desirable, and ever fresh, like the fruit we see in still life painting? What allows it to never go out of fashion? If you think of the 89-year-old Campari bottle designed in 1932 or the 88-year Moka Bialetti designed in 1933, you see my point. How does one create a classic then? How can we nurture the creativity of timelessness? Here is where a mere descriptive or chronological approach to Italian design would fall short. Here is where a genealogical point of view explains instead Italian design as the contemporary expression of a much deeper cultural imagery. In exploring this cultural echo chamber of Italian design, I would consider the influence that Italy's visual, literary, and philosophical heritage sheds on creativity and entrepreneurial thinking. So I will observe now objects as storytelling devices, the relationship between literary originality and industrial authenticity, and the Italian philosophy of design. Now, how does one turn a serial object into a unique story? By becoming an actor, a character, a thinking device. So the tension to transform surfaces or matter into storytelling screens is really overwhelming in pre-industrial Italy. We can even date it back to ancient Rome, as we see in the spiraling bas-relief of the Trajan Column, a narrative reel in color relating the emperor's victory and conquest of Dacia, now Romania. We can see the same idea in Italian ceilings, which are often turn from architectural covers into spectacular screens. So in the starry skies of Ravenna's Byzantine mausoleum of Galla Placidia, or Giotto medieval Scrovegni Chapel in Padua, or in the open sky of Andrea Pozzo's Baroque apotheosis of St. Ignatius in Rome, or in modern times in the arcades of Milan's Galleria Vittorio Emanuele II and Naples' Galleria Umberto I. Against this backdrop, where even ordinary things like dishes or chests become a narrative support, industrialization produces a radical shift, moving the storytelling tension of an object from the exterior facade to the interior, so from landscape to inscape. With the beginning of serial production, objects can no longer be just decorative platforms, but rather need to become unique embodiments. They are no longer surfaces that tell a story, but rather they are the story. In this sense, while the artisan or the artist used to convey an object or a surface its relevance by adorning it with a story, the industrial designer needs to become a storyteller, endowing prototypes with a plot, a life, or a concept that rescues the object from anonymity. For a designer, as well as for a great storyteller, the key to relevance in a narration is to show but not tell, embody but not explain, lead but not patronize. The ancient poet Horace simply called it docere delectando, teaching by delight. But how can a designer create value without being patronizing? How can functionality embody a plot? Let's see how the Italian focus on applied arts offers an experimental stimulus to explore variation, detect life in matter, and turn abstract concepts into lively plastic representations. Painting provides an explorative space of variation in the works of Giovanni Boldini and Giorgio Morandi. Boldini reconfigures the serial space of portraiture into a storytelling platform by turning dresses into the protagonists of his gallery of women, by seeing in their design the value, the punctum, the salt of the composition. In the same way, Academy Award winner costume designer Milena Canonero sees the abito not just as a dress, but also as a visual expression of a habit, a temperament. So the dress is the character. In the space of Giorgio Morandi's still life painting, we find the same method. By placing bottles of various shapes and colors within the space of a canvas, Morandi sets up a space of serialization and variation, allowing the investigation of different ways of being and exploring the transformation of objects into actors or abstract forms, often mirroring the skyline of his city, Bologna. A bottle, then, is not just a bottle, but rather a platform of theatrical and plastic variations, as we see in the Italian obsession to design its new shapes. So from Boccioni's development of a bottle in space to the Peros Campari bottle. So an object is not just an object, but a thinking device or a living plot. And we see this in a famous ad by Teodoro Ferrari for the Olivetti typewriter M1, where the product is not only worth the creativity, intellect, and imagination of a great poet like Dante, but also becomes, de facto, a legitimate storytelling object. Another common expression of the tension to turn objects into animated characters is their connection to the animal world, as we see in Elsa Schiaparelli's lobster dress, designed with Salvador Dalí in 1936 for Duchess Wallis Simpson, in Gaia Olenti's whimsical bat-shaped lamp, the pipistrello designed for Martinelli in 1965, in the Vespa scooter, the wasp designed by Corradino d'Ascanio in 1946, or in the Grillo telephone, the cricket from the sound of its ringer, designed by Marco Zanuso and Richard Sapper for Siemens in 1966. How does an object embody an idea? For many Italian designers, automobiles expressed moving and experimental embodiments of an idea, as we see in the 1970s concept cars by Marcello Gandini, Sergio Pininfarina, or Giorgetto Giugiaro. A striking case of object concept is the FIFA World Cup, designed in 1971 by the Italian sculptor Silvio Gazzaniga, founder of GDE Bertoni, a leading industry in the production of trophies. The cup embodies the abstract concept of victory in three visual forms: the word, the athlete, and the effort required to win. The top sphere, featuring the relief of continents and assimilating the earth to a ball, reflects the universal value of soccer, gathering all nations in a common quest. The triumphant athlete represents a man that victory has transformed into a giant, and his doubling turns personal achievement into shared harmony, peace, and freedom. The effort and commitment that is required to achieve in sports find plastic expression in the helicoidal movement of lines from the bottom to the top, giving the trophy momentum and ideally prolonging the lifting gesture of the captain to an upward or transcendent dimension. So, if objects are the story, how can they tell a relevant one? Many movies or books are published every year, but only a few capture our interest and remain over time. How can an object stand out, then? How is originality produced? Here's where the investigation of literary models can provide a useful insight into the creation of industrial authenticity. The method a writer adopts to achieve originality are, in fact, quite similar to those of a designer. And I will explore a few literary patterns to make my points. And I'm sure you're familiar with two great Italian musicians, the 19th century violin virtuoso Niccolò Paganini and the 20th century orchestra director Arturo Toscanini. The two artists personify two leading paradigms of literary originality, as well as two key Italian paths to innovation. A monolingual one, embodied by Petrarch, focused on the zealous, almost compulsive attention to the inimitable purity or perfection of one ingredient, and a multilingual one, expressed in Dante, aiming at balancing different voices in a tempered orchestration. As for the virtuoso ability in honing the sound of his violin, the model of the medieval poet Petrarch identifies perfection of making, so the word poetry means creative making, in the consistency, purity, and excellence of language. So Petrarch's master ingredient, his prima donna, was language itself, its uniqueness, its wholeness, its coherent stylization. In entrepreneurial terms, Petrarch's ideal of perfection as obsessive quest for the purity of the ingredient translates into an exclusive focus on a flawless standalone product. According to this model, the value element, the innovation, what makes a product stand out is the visible difference of its superior ingredient or materials, or its masterful execution. Petrarch perfected his lyrical expression over the 30-year work of his canzoniere, providing a century-long framework to European poetry, Shakespeare included. His monolingual approach applies to the food industry in the excellence of production, in the premium positioning, in the finding, perfecting, and refining of one ingredient, from artisanal pasta to salame felino, from torrone to parmigiano reggiano. The masterful pursuit of the perfect ingredient also refers to elements or materials. The focus on the ingredient is a key of success for Casadei, top brand in the production of stilettos and high heels. For Brugola, the world's leader in the production of bolts and critical fasteners. For Brembo, number one company in the production of brakes for sports cars. With regard to materials, the monolingual obsession finds expression in the craft of glassmaking, Murano in marble cutting. The Carrara quarries provided the perfect stone for Milan's cathedral, and even steel, as seen in the work of Cimolai, which turned steel from a construction tool into a versatile aesthetic material, as we see in the vessel in New York. The opposite of Petrarch's model of rarefaction and wholesomeness is Dante's Divine Comedy, where innovation springs forth from the hybridization of different timbres, voices, registers, and dialects, and in their harmonization in an all-embracing vision. In the comedy, where swear words are woven with theological discourse, the artistry of the poet lies in the ability to see elements not in an atomistic or hypertrophic way, but rather as part of a temperate interaction, of an overall construction of meaning. As in the orchestra, so the Toscanini model, where the individual voice finds perfection in the symphonic ensemble of diversities, and where the melody is not owned by one but carries over from instrument into instrument. Dante, in the same way, uses a particular word to express this, which is kind of a horizontal balance of themes, languages, and voices, and also a vertical connection of the present with its previous layers, styles, inputs, and elements coming from different ages or civilization. And Dante calls this with a Latin word, the word concinitas, which means the singing together of different expressions. This plural dimension of the artwork, this attitude to transport an overarching aesthetic idea or melody from a specific language or art to another, this polyphonic approach has an industrial equivalent in the models of Campari and Olivetti, who similarly saw their products as generative platforms of interdisciplinary connections. So Davide Campari conceived his drink, not by chance a mixer in a cocktail, as a locus of concinitas and as a mixing laboratory of multiple aesthetic languages. So the ironsmith Alessandro Mazzucotelli designed the chandelier of his bar Camparino in Milan. The illustrators Marcello Dudovic, Leonetto Cappiello and Marcello Nizzoli designed its unforgettable posters. The painter Fortunato De Pero designed the company's bottle and architectural pavilions. And closer to us, the top fashion photographer Christian Schuller worked on the 2013 calendar with Penelope Cruz, and directors like Federico Fellini and Paolo Sorrentino authored an ad and the mini movie Killer in Red. Similarly, Adriano Olivetti made his typewriter business a piazza, where technology meets design, philosophy meets engineering, and architecture meets politics. We see it in the hiring of top designers like Nizzoli, Sozzas, Bellini, leading engineers like Perotto, Mario Chu. Perotto developed in 1964 the computer that NASA scientists adopted for the Apollo 11 mission. The hiring of architects like Pollini and Figini, who designed the headquarters of the company in Ivrea in rationalist style in the 1930s, or Carlo Scarpa, who designed the Olivetti Store Museum in Venice. And we can also see how Olivetti applies this vision to the transformation of Ivrea from a city into a social political model of comunità. Now, two other literary models further illustrate the link between cultural imagery and Italian design, and I'm referring here to the rivalry of Ariosto and Tasso, authors of the two most read chivalric poems of the 16th century, Orlando Furioso and Jerusalem Delivered. Now, the Orlando Furioso is an open-ended narration, with no precise start and no clear end. It's a continuum of weaving stories in a dynamic movement of ramification and variation. The Jerusalem Delivered follows instead a beginning, development, end scheme, framing the story into a self-contained theater. In the first model, originality is achieved through a combinatory game. The second, through heightened emotions. Ariosto's method consists in the infinite ramification of one theme, love as folly, explored through an endless weaving of deviations and shifting planes. The Renaissance painter Botticelli and the Baroque sculptor Bernini adopted the same method, the creation of variables over an established visual identity, in the elaboration of a feminine model of beauty for different canvases, replicable model, or of a coherent set of statues to fill the colonnade of St. Peter's Square. The authoring of a matrix that can extend to different parts is an early form of prototyping, as well as the shifting of a theme from one plane to another. And we see this in the modern age in the story of Corradino d'Ascanio's Vespa, which is really the result of the shifting of concepts from one realm to another. The research on light and sturdy bodies transfer from airplanes to scooters, and the application of agile mobility transfer from the military vehicles used by US parachuters during World War II to move quickly behind the enemy lines to an urban setting. Tasso's model of the self-enclosed stage, dominated by rigid units of time and space, produces instead a heightening of feelings, causing poetry to overflow into theatrical performance, emotions to reach their climax, and details, characters, and events to exude pathos in the attempt to transcend an established limit. And such theatrical energy finds expression in early advertising, which draws its language from opera posters by recording designers, where the limited space of a frame enclosed in a snapshot the entire visual, oral, and emotional atmosphere of melodrama. The heightening of passions is also a key element in the Olivetti Valentine designed by Ettore Sozzas and Perry King in 1968, which gives emotional impact to the idea of liberation from the wire as the first portable typewriter ever, and from the sexual morals against the backdrop of the sexual revolution. Now, one last reference is needed before closing our literary digression, and it's impossible to talk about design and literature without mentioning Geppetto, father of Pinocchio and key archetype for Italian designers. In the opening of Collodi's The Adventures of Pinocchio, Geppetto examines a piece of wood in the company of another carpenter, the red-nosed Maestro Ciliegia. Master Cherry wants to make a chair, but is puzzled at hearing a thin little voice coming from the log. While Cherry denies hearing anything and discards this piece, Geppetto fights over it and claims it for himself, imagining it as a puppet that could dance and fence and sing. So, materialism of matter versus the imagination of matter. The object's external surface versus its inner life. Geppetto's ability to hear the voice of matter and develop its hidden potential is also made manifest in a later scene of the book, where he wears his Pinocchio puppet by turning bark into shoes, paper into clothes, and stale bread into a hat. In these two scenes, we find reflected the Italian vision of matter as a living agent, and of scarcity as a creative resource. Italian design objects are often puppets or actors, as we see in the Mama Chair by Gaetano Pesce, the carton bookcase by Ettore Sozzas, the Tolomeo Lamp by Michele De Lucchi and Giancarlo Fassina, or Alessandro Mendini's collections for Alessi. With regard to scarcity, the idea of limit as a creative tool is a common trope in Italy. In literature, limit or constraint allows to dominate the artistic impulse and overcome the banality of expression. As we see in the rigid expressive formats of Dante's Terza Rima or Petrarch's sonnet. In the food industry, the creative use of leftover is a key form of innovation in the cuisine of world-renowned chef Massimo Bottura. In the case of Ferrero and Nutella, the factor that led to the idea of mixing chocolate with hazelnut, the only available ingredient in the Lange region, was in fact the post-war scarcity of cocoa. In design, a poor metal like aluminum, extolled by fascism to make up for Italy's lack of resources, became the key component of Bialetti's mocha. Now, these considerations lead us to consider Italian design not just as a clever form of styling or storytelling, but rather as a form of practical thinking, as a philosophy of gesture. The word gesture, from the Latin gerere, to bring, indicates the intentional configuration of a product as a carrier of value, meaning, or substance. But what does a product carry? The definition of communication by the 19th century Milanese writer Alessandro Manzoni applies to literature and products alike. So a book or an object, in his words, should aim at the useful as goal, the true as subject, and the interesting as means. In design terms, we could paraphrase at the functional as goal, the genuine as subject, and the appealing as means. What design brings is the empowerment of objects, things, and gestures from mere use to lasting meaning, relevance, and novelty. Not through a coherent philosophy, but rather through a hybrid or a systematic thought. Design, then, is a paradoxical creative gesture, where poetry as creative imagination and practice as material execution are not separate, where theory and know-how are intertwined, where the object and its space coincide, as we see in the Greek words techne, which means both art and technique, so intentional planning and self-adjusting practice, and in the word cosmos, which means both ornament, so cosmetic, and universe, so the cosmic. Rather than applying a theory upon objects, the Italian philosophy of design starts from objects as self-adjusting expressions of a world. It does not come as a surprise then that its founding father, Joe Ponti, is not an academic or a philosopher, but rather the first ever Italian creative director for Richard Ginori, the organizer of the first design exposition, so the Biennale of Monza and later Milan's Triennale, a renowned architect and designer, as well as the founder of the journal Domus, which became the accomplished expression of the Italian design movement. The journal offered a space of reflection, exhibition, and education, promoting design as a multidisciplinary language connecting objects to people, spaces, and lifestyles, and also as a philosophy of perspective, enacting a dynamic 3D knowledge of reality. In this context, Ponti saw industry as the new culture maker, objects as expressions of a cultural mindset, and the designer as the new modern intellectual, offering a synthesis of pragmatism and art, functionality and beauty, manufacture and aesthetics. As a way to identify the pillars of this asystematic philosophy of Italian design, we need to go back to at least three Renaissance archetypes. The first, which I draw from Leonardo's Last Supper in Milan, is the inseparable link of the creative and technical mind. So the technical execution and the aesthetic planning coincide in the dry fresco, which created a cultural context for a refectory, connecting a convent dining hall to the last meal of Christ, but also prolonging the lighting and depth of the room, placing the fresco in an ideal perspective. So to design is to draw, disegno, but also to plan. It is a strategizing and storytelling intelligence. Technical planning allows to achieve perspective and place an object within a context, so a testing mindset that is now taken over by virtual reality. Storytelling is the value creator and the condition for an innovation to become meaningful. It is not enough to do the right thing or plan exactly. What is required to achieve relevance is visual persuasiveness. And this is why, for example, Galileo Galilei decided not just to refer, but rather to stage his telescope observations of the moon through visual storytelling in the Sidereal Messenger and later in the fictional dialogue on the chief word systems. The second pillar of the Italian philosophy of design, which I draw from Raphael's famous school of Athens, is the continuity of ideal and physical worlds. The dialogue between an ideal perfection of forms, so Plato upward gesture, and matter-of-factness, Aristotle downward gesture. This image reflects the coincidence of necessity and potential, the union of material and spiritual, the finiteness and self-transcending dimension of objects, which is really at the base of Italian design. So from what we saw in Italy, a chair is not just a chair. A bottle is not just a bottle. Business is not solely a trade, but also a philosophical condition of busyness, of constant pursuit of something that can quench our thirst for true and meaningful interactions. This coincidence between pensare, to think, and its root pesare, to weigh, is synthesized in Ponti's writings, but also expressed in the approach to business and entrepreneurship of the Kashmir entrepreneur Brunello Cucinelli, who reconfigured his headquarters of Solomeo in Umbria as an ideal Renaissance city and shaped his company around the philosophy of Aristotle, Marcus Aurelius, Saint Benedict, Kant, and Rousseau. So the coincidence of poesis and praxis, creative and practical doing, the continuity of ideal and matter. The third pillar, which I draw from Michelangelo's Unfinished Prisoners, is a perennial sense of hybridity, in-betweenness, incompleteness, eliciting a perennial urge to find new synthesis. In Michelangelo's Prisoners, incompleteness is not a job left undone, but rather a creative mindset of self-adjustment. As for Geppetto's ability to hear a voice in wood, Michelangelo plays with marble to be able to listen, to experiment with, to extract from the concrete a lively ideal, to free matter. Moreover, the unfinished nature of his prisoners indicates a malleable space left open to continuous amendment, a laboratory of new solutions, a site of constant synthesis and reconfiguration. And in this image, we see that incompleteness is a self-imposed urgency, or rather a working method, forcing the artist to not rely upon a pre-established ideology or predefined format or customized solutions, but rather to always start from scratch. This experimental attitude is not only a key antidote against serialization or the sclerosis of the past, but it is also the condition to constantly achieve freshness and newness. So, how does this genealogy of design, of Italian design, affect yachting? Yacht design is actually the synthesis of all we have said. Why? Well, yachts are storytelling platforms and living stories. They are a privileged setting for literature and cinematography, but also story in themselves, mirroring a self in space, giving form to a personality in the unique interaction of objects and architecture. Yachts are the synthesis of a dynamic philosophy where the ideal and the material, the contingent and the eternal, continuously intersect, where doing well is inseparable from doing with meaning. This really goes back to a long tradition of excellence in shipbuilding and boat storytelling, and Dante is a good witness of both. On the one hand, in his homage to the grandeur of the Venetian arsenal in Inferno 21, where he compares the tireless activity of devils to the relentless labor of the shipyard, where one makes a vessel new, one recocks the ribs of a boat that has made many a voyage, one hammers at a prow, one at the stern, and another mends the mainsail. In this, he offers a lively testimony of the excellence of Italian shipbuilding already in the 14th century, at the time of Italy's sea republics. On the other hand, in one of his early poems, Guido vorrei che tu l'apo io, which is one of the most beautiful naval writings of Italian literature, he constructs the boat as a space of freedom, imagination, and quest for the divine. As he connects a trip with his friends Guido and Lapo on his vessel to the enchantment of beauty, friendship, love, and endless storytelling. So the Florentine Dante, who, like the Florentine sailor Amerigo Vespucci, was not coming from a city on the coast, imagined himself boarding a vessel and being transported wherever the sea would bring him and his friends, and equates his sea journey to the experience of being in a single wish with them, thinking as one, growing in desire to be together, inviting other girls, and never being content to always reason about love. Doing well, a traditional craft handed from generation to generation, and doing with meaning. A boat is not just a boat, but a complex architecture of meaning. Luxury is the synthesis of such unique combination of execution and authorial freshness. The plus value of an Italian yacht is then its lively connection to a particular history and philosophy, its dynamic fusion of wholesome objects and coherent spaces, and its organic interaction of craft and aesthetic vision. How is this created? Where is this assembled? An answer to this question certainly comes from the incredible technological advancements of the industry. What I can add is the cultural vision of three sites that define the social enterprise of Italian yacht building and ground its performance as both results and showmanship: the fabbrica, the court, and theater. Now, the word fabbrica now exclusively means plant, but in the early modern age, it expressed the life, network of skills and ideals of a working community in the surroundings of a church, so la fabbrica di San Pietro, del Duomo, del Rosario. Whatever project it might be, especially those with a long-term breath, there was a fabbrica, where sculptors, artisans, architects, painters, stone cutters, wood carvers, but also investors, philosophers, or academics interacted in a shared endeavor to outlast time. In this context, the value of work did not rely upon an authorial voice, so the statues of the Duomo are not signed, but rather in the idea of labor as prayer, as relationship with God, or in more secular terms, as the expression of a common value. This choral and individual model of participation in a long-lasting project is a core asset for a luxury company, where authorship is not a griff or logo, but rather consists in the shared quality of the parts, in their singing ensemble, concinitas. Also, in industrial terms, the idea of fabbrica indicates a shared productive effort, a choral art of doing, as we see in the industrial cities of Crespi d'Adda, built in the 19th century around the workers of a cotton plant, or of Ivrea, where Camillo and Adriano Olivetti built an avant-garde of technical research and design around a utopian city, community of artists, writers, workers, and architects. And in the same way, a shipyard is a fabbrica, a coordinated process of technological and cultural interactions, where artisanal manufacturing relates to a choral vision, where engineering intersects the imaginative, where doing is not mere fabricating, but embodying a world of meaning. The second important space is that of the court. A yacht, like a court, is the expression and self-projection of a unique personality. It's a dynamic monument which literally warns the mind, as in its Latin root, about its owner for both present and future generations. The yacht, like a court, is a sophisticated environment of social communication. In a court, objects, dresses, and styles are non-verbal codes of expression and spaces, performative sites for its micro-society. But how does a duke show elegance without arrogance? How does prodigality avoid vanity or self-exhibition? The 16th century diplomat Baldassare Castiglione identified a key trait of the Italian way to display wealth, power, and influence in the word sprezzatura, which means complex simplicity, graceful ease, sophisticated effortlessness. In a similar way, a yacht must be a site of magnificence and simplicity, self-projection and performance, excellence and effortlessness. In its refined elegance, timeless functionality, and ability to manifest by hiding, to show by embodying. So yachts are then performative sites of an uncompromising mentality or of a unique personality, but also at the same time, repositories of codes, meanings, stories, and words that have been acquired through use along the journey. They are really a court of imprese, the Italian word which means both enterprises and adventures, both entrepreneurial endeavors and unforgettable events. The last space I want to mention here is theater. The house as theater, as in the case of Palazzo Te in Mantua, where rooms are atmospheres, today we will call them installations, but also the theater as a polyvalent structure of meaning, as we see at La Scala, Milan's and the world's most famous opera house. Opera, which is the Latin for works, represents the theatrical space par excellence, as a coherent fusion of languages, the works of literature, music, set and costume design, acting, lighting, and business as well. So yachts are opera houses, as magnificent syntheses of different languages and dynamic sites where a concept or a story becomes an emotional story, a sung story, our story, not as a standard replica, but always as a new live performance. Now, the design and building of a ship is also an opera in the balanced outcome of its works, of its single unique ingredients, Petrarch, of its unique score, so the prototype, of its unique ensemble, Dante's concomitant, and its unique livelihood, so the adjustment and synthesis. The livelihood of a ship consists then in its plot line, in its performance, or, as Dante would call it, in its enchantment, connecting a naval journey to each person's life voyage and beyond. As an opera continues to be performed over time, always acquiring new meanings, a ship similarly becomes a cultural crossroads, where a world of users, centuries of voyagers, storytellers and explorers, generations of sailors, craftsmen, poets, philosophers, architects and designers come alive anew, participating, substantiating and initiating new powerful stories. All of this is behind the success of the Italian nautical industry. And we go back to where we started. Italian design is not a label. It's a cultural brand. It's a chamber room. It might seem that it might not make any difference, but the convergence in an object of a word, a lifestyle, a heritage is the quintessential value creator. And the ability to turn an object into a symphony of endless meaning is the way to construct a boat or any other product as an ever-performing prima donna. Grazie.